Hi, my name is Oliver Damien. I've always had this desire to start a YouTube channel where I could just talk about the things that's on my mind. And it's one of those things that I had so many excuses to delay starting it. Like, I need a good camera, I need to learn how to edit, I need to do this and that, I need to make it good, I need to make it perfect. And then years later, nothing's happened. But the desire is still there. And so yesterday, I went to this NewCo event where we go to different companies. And one of the companies that we went to was Airtasker. And the co-founder of Airtasker here in Sydney talked about, how he founded the company and all the stuff. And in one of the slides he presented, it just says jump, focus, and innovate. So the first move is really to jump in and then focus on building it and then innovating, make it better. I know all of this in theory because I've read the Lean Startup. So it just start with a minimum viable product. So I'm gonna pull my finger out and I'm just gonna follow this desire to start a YouTube channel. It's gonna be rough at first, it's gonna be whatever, but I'm just gonna do it and I'm just gonna jump into it, and this is the first episode. So the way I will do it is to set a container of 15 minutes. So I have my insight timer. So I'm gonna start timing and I'm just gonna talk every day for 15 minutes about what's going on with me, what I'm feeling, the ideas I have, just anything and everything. And here we go. I'm gonna press start now with the timer. So that would count down. There's a 10-second warm up. So the tentative title I have for, so it starts now, the 15 minutes starts now. So the tentative title that I have for this channel would be Confessions of a Complex Human. So I'm doing this double bachelor degree here at UTS, University of Technology in Sydney, and I'm doing product design, and the other bachelor is creative intelligence and innovation. So the creative intelligence and innovation side of the degree, we do it like in between semesters, and we just finished the summer school recently, and the topic was complexity, and it really, really opened my mind. And I'm one of those people who can't seem to focus on one thing, and I always thought it's such a flaw in me, like I want creative things, but then I did economics and then I did law, I became a lawyer, but all this time I had all these creative urges to do creative stuff. Until finally I hit a wall and said, I'm gonna do this, I'm gonna do creative stuff, I'm just gonna let my creativity come out. So I'm doing that now, and this channel is one of the ways I'm doing it. So I just recently came back to Sydney this February 8th, and I spent 6 months in the Netherlands. I was on exchange for my product design degree, and I did this thing called a minor in interactive environments. So it's where they put people from different faculties, students from different faculties, so that we could work together into building interactive environments, which is like putting sensors and microcontrollers in the built environment so that things can respond to you. I'll say more on that in the next videos. But the reason I brought it up is one thing I really love about the Dutch culture, actually two things, is that first, they're direct. And having grown up in the Philippines, the Filipino culture is more indirect. It's more like don't rock the boat kind of mentality or way of being. So it was quite refreshing to have directness everywhere. And they did, you know, in when I went to TU Delft, which is their technical university at Delft in the Netherlands. So Delft is just above Rotterdam and below The Hague, Den Haag. So it's like a south of Holland. That's another thing I learned, that Holland is not really the Netherlands. So Holland is part of the Netherlands. It's a bit like England, Wales, Northern Ireland, and the United Kingdom. So these are two. So these are the things you learn when one learns when one goes on exchange. So anyway, before we started the minor, we had this introduction to Dutch culture, you know, someone talks about it, and that's one of the things they said. The Dutch were direct, and just you have to get used to it. And I did see it, like in the minor I did, there's a lot of ideation, you know, and since people are coming from different disciplines, each one would have different views on the same thing, on the same thing we're looking at. And they would just say, like, I would say, this is the concept I have, and one person would just say, I don't like it. Boom. Directly. There's no like, it's good, but it just say, I don't like it, and they'll say the reason why. And we'll just do this. And at first I said, shit. How can you get anything done? And people would just say things like that. But actually, it made things better because things moved on faster. So we know the things we don't agree on, and then by eliminating that, we were able to find things we agreed on, and it made it more effective, more efficient. But so that's the first thing I liked about the Dutch culture, is that they're direct. But being direct alone wouldn't be enough. Like if you're just direct with what I think, if I'm just a direct, then I'd be like an asshole just trying to impose my will on the world and not caring, you know. The other side of the Dutch culture which I like is they want to hear everyone's opinion. So on one side they're direct, but on the other side they want to hear everyone. So in my group, and in the way the coaches were facilitating the group sessions, if someone's not speaking, they would have to say, hey, so-and-so, what do you think? So I think based on what I read and based on what people tell me, it's because like in the early days of the Netherlands, they had to work really together because a lot of the land they just reclaimed, you know, they just got it out of the sea, and they had to build all of these mechanisms to keep the land, to keep the water from flooding the reclaimed land. So they had to work together, and I think it's called the polder mentality, Dutch polder. So in doing that, you have to hear everyone's opinion, because otherwise it wouldn't work. If you're bottling up all these things and you don't say it, it won't work for group dynamics. So anyway, those are the two things I like. And how that relates to this video cast or this YouTube channel that I want to start is that I want to hear people's thoughts, people's opinions on things. And I guess in the mass media culture that developed during the industrial age, like it's experts or celebrities or media people who have like a monopoly on this, which shouldn't be the case. Everyone should be heard. And I want that. That's why I attend a lot of events. Like I've been into Q&A, which is a show here in Australia where they just have panels and people in the audience can ask any questions. And I also attend a lot of IQ 2 debates, or if I can't attend them, I just watch them on YouTube. So the point being is I want to hear as many opinions or as many views as possible, instead of just being stuck with the two main views as created by media or whatever, or the advertising industry or the PR industry. So I want that, But I would be a hypocrite if I just won it and just sat here and wait for people to do that. So if I want that to happen, then I should start it. And I shouldn't be a hypocrite. So by being true, then I should start it. So this is my way of starting it. I'm going to be brave and I'm going to put out there the views I have on things. And thank God for the wonderful internet that we have now and sites like YouTube. I don't need permission from an editor or a media company owner to publish. I can just publish it. And if people like it, they can subscribe. So if you like what you're hearing now, then just press the subscribe button. And then so that you can be informed when I publish the next edition or the next episode of this Confessions of a Complex Human. So that's the idea behind this. So I'm going to confess my views and the things on how I see the world and also how I feel. And with the hope that by doing this, it will encourage discussion. So if you have comments, please comment below and I will try to reply in the next episode. So just put your comments there. And if you want me to talk about certain topics or you can ask any questions, just put it in the comments and I would address it in the next episode. So the other component of this is, you know, we are already in the digital age, and in fact most of my classmates in university and most of the younger people I know are digital natives. Like they were born with all this infrastructure, they were born with the internet being there. That's good, right? Because we can see movies, TV shows on demand. I could publish this easily. Like I could record this using a laptop, which has become like a utility now, or we have mobile phones that are quite cheap. And in fact, people in what they used to call third world countries or developing countries are leapfrogging the so-called first world. In the first world, they started with having phone lines, and then which was copper, and then after copper they made it into fiber optics, and then they made it into mobile phones, so from wired to wireless. But in these countries, in these developing countries, they just leapfrog that. Because it's too hard really to create this massive infrastructure of ducts underground and then all this copper and all this wiring. It's actually the most expensive part of the network, as what the National Broadband Network is finding out here in Australia. And I could talk more about that if you want me to, because I have experience in being involved in looking at that. So what I was saying is that these countries are leapfrogging it, and they're just starting from mobile first, which incidentally is a web design movement now, that when you design something, design with the mobile first in mind, because that's the most widespread way of people accessing the internet. So what I was saying is these are all good things, but like everything, things are not always good. There are dark sides. Like you have the light and there's always the shadow. One of the shadows of being in a digital world is that a lot of things are digital, right? So it's easy for the NSA and people like that to spy on us. That's one thing. But the other thing as well is, like, if I don't share this, like, let's say I record it and I just keep it in my hard drive, and then I die, and then no one knows my passwords and things like that, then it's lost forever. In the past, when we were more analog, when it's more atoms than bits, you know, people wrote letters to each other. They kept paper diaries. So when they die, after they died, people will discover it. So we are lucky enough to find the diaries of like Da Vinci and Newton, and the correspondence between Newton and Leibniz, I think. So because of that, we sort of have a glimpse of what it was like to live during that time by analyzing these artifacts that survived. But now in the digital world, if it's all digital and like that, it's not shared, or it's just in my hard drive, and then my hard drive goes kaput, and it's all gone. And so archiving digital stuff is interesting. It's a challenge, and there's fear that we may be losing, because a lot of websites go up and then they don't exist anymore, and we've lost that. And I think it's important to, because I was a lawyer. I worked in litigation for a while, and I worked as a lawyer for 7 years. So in court, a lot of weight is given to contemporaneous evidence. These are the things that, let's say, emails that happened at the time at the relevant time of the case. So let's say it's a competition case where people were colluding or doing cartel, and one guy sent an email at that time that discussed prices that they agree on, things like that. And then that's why in litigation you have discovery, so you have to give the other side all the raw documents. So that's the time, that means 15 minutes. I'm just gonna quickly wrap up, and then I'll see you in the next episode. So to wrap up, what I'm saying is, it's important that we have a record of things as they happen at the moment, because there is no substitute for that. So in court, people can write like affidavits of what happened, what they think happened at the relevant time. But you know, the way we look at the past is a bit biased. There's like confirmation bias, or it's already colored by who we are right now. So when we look at the past, it's colored by what happened between then and now. So it's not as good as when the thing was happening and then we wrote about it. So the point is, I'm doing these videos is that I'm doing it as I am now, so that it's a contemporaneous record of a guy, a person, a human, living in 2017, and what it is like, so that in the future, 100 years from now, people could look back, hey, this is what people were thinking back then. And the reason I'm going to share it in the channel is that there's records of it, and I'm going to share it in multiple channels, so that if one channel goes down, if YouTube goes down, it's on Vimeo, and I'm going to also get the audio. So it's just the only way to survive the intransigency of digital media is to have lots of copies of it, hoping that one of them will survive. So this is, in a way, my contribution to the historical record for the future. And I encourage you to do the same. So the bell has rang, our time is up. And I hope if you like this, please subscribe. And then if you have questions, and if your interest has been piqued by what I say, just write it in the comments. And tomorrow I'm gonna try my best to address it, depending on how many comments I get. I'm gonna try to respond. Okay, it's Friday here in Sydney right now. So have a good Friday and have a good weekend. And I hope to see you tomorrow in this channel. Bye.